from theCUBE studios in Palo Alto and Boston, bringing you data-driven insights from theCUBE and ETR. This is Breaking Analysis with Dave Vellante.
Hi everybody, welcome to this special Breaking Analysis where we look back and grade ourselves on our 2025 enterprise technology predictions. As you know, this is the time of year we're getting tons of inbounds from all the PR firms and other thought leaders that are sharing with us their predictions. We just sat through John Rose's predictions. He's CTO of Dell. Yesterday he gave five of his top predictions for 2026. And so we publish, as you know, in January each year. The CUBE research team and I do a set of predictions. I do a set of predictions with the Data Gang, Tony Baer, Sanjeev Mohan, and that crew. And of course, I do Breaking Analysis predictions with Eric Bradley each year. So we'll be doing that in January after the new ETR data comes out. But let's take a look back at our 2025 predictions, and we'll do the grading system. Alex, if you bring up this first slide, which just kind of shows all the predictions that we did. They range from tech spending. We always do something there. Of course, we had to talk about agentic. We gave some predictions in cloud. And then we always like to try to talk about the markets and data and AI. So we'll get into it. Let's see, Alex. Let's start with the first prediction, which was this slide here, number one. Tech spending increases 5% in 2025. That was our prediction. We entered the year with IT decision makers expecting 5.3% growth. But you can see here on that the bottom right-hand side of this chart in 2025 throughout the year, with tariff concerns and all the economic uncertainty, we saw a pretty precipitous drop to about 3.4%. It bumped up a little bit to 3.6%, bumped back down and sort of, you know, stayed in that 3% range. We're now entering 2026 with the expectation that it will be growing at 4.9 or 5%. But we gave ourselves a C on this prediction because, well, we missed. I mean, generally speaking, we think that IT spending, when we're talking about budgets here, is going to come in at the low single digits, 3 to 4%. So we were off. Now, when you look at, like, for instance, IDC numbers, we had Crawford Del Pret on before. I mean, he's talking double digit growth, but they're counting, of course, all the CapEx that's going in there. We're looking at IT spending. So we're talking to IT decision makings, looking at what their budget increases are. And, you know, when we exited, Alex, if you bring that slide back up, when we exited COVID, you can see here on the left, it was over 7% expectation. And then as the interest rates, you know, continued to rise, it was inversely proportional to tech spending. So that's the situation there. We give ourselves a C. All right, let's bring up the next one, Alex. Number two, despite tools creep, platformization remains a cyber theme. We gave ourselves a B here. This is just a quick snapshot from the January 2026 survey. It's preliminary data. But the reason I used that was that red dotted line at 40%. There were more companies above that red dotted line last year. You had Zscaler up there. You had Palo Alto up there above it. Even Cloudflare was up there. And now they're sort of below that 40% line. Only Microsoft and Wiz are above that 40% line. So there's some indications of consolidation. Obviously, the Wiz acquisition is an indicator. Clearly, Palo Alto Networks and CrowdStrike are having success with the consolidation strategy and what Nikesh Arora at Palo Alto calls the platformization of security. At the same time, so we gave ourselves a B on this because, you know, the reason is at the same time, when we talk to practitioners, they continue to bring in new tools. Like, for instance, just this week, we had Obsidian Security on, Hassam, the CEO. We discussed why we needed another, you know, security company. And of course, they're focused on agentic within SaaS, securing agents within SaaS platforms, which of course is growing. So that's a niche that, you know, necessarily Palo Alto and CrowdStrike and others might not be attacking today. And so there's this need for additional tooling. So as a result, you know, we gave ourselves a B because we're seeing some signs of consolidation, but maybe not to the degree that we had originally predicted. All right, let's bring up the next one. Number three, no aha moment for agentic AI in 2025. As security and data privacy concerns slow adoption. You can see here, we pulled the slide that we used last year from ETR. This is new data from ETR. So you can see human-guided copilots. So how would you classify the autonomy level of AI agents? It's really human-guided copilots and semi-autonomous agents. Really, you know, copilots from Microsoft obviously are the big one, but the fully autonomous agents that operate end-to-end workflows, you know, it's very, very limited. Full self-driving, if you will, of agentic is not yet a thing. Most of this that's going on, it's like RPA on steroids, RPA 2.0. They're really digital assistants as co-pilots, but adoption is significant. Only 7%, it's not shown here, but in a previous survey, only 7% aren't using AI agents. But the way in which they're being used is still, in many cases, quasi-deterministic. It's still not sort of systems of agency. So we gave ourselves an A- on this one. I think we, pretty much said last year that this was going to be the year of agent washing, not so much, agentic, real agent usefulness. George Gilbert makes a joke that there's more sort of agent chatbots than there are fleas on a camel's back. So I think we'll take the A minus on that one. All right, next one. Number four, cloud repatriates shift their narrative to on-prem AI. We gave ourselves a B plus here. You know, the thinking was that, first of all, we still don't see repatriation as a major trend. You know, it's still, single digit repatriation. If you look at the percent of customers that are investing in IaaS and PaaS, it continues to grow, continues to outpace, on-prem. And here's a flash survey or a drill down survey that ETR did of 140 respondents, thinking about the total number of workloads at your company, irrespective of where they are deployed. How has the number changed in the past 12 months? And how do you expect it to change? You can see that, we're showing the increase in cloud workloads, continues to grow, and people aren't, decreasing the cloud workloads. So we gave ourselves a B plus on that one. When you look at all the data, it's pretty consistent. All right, the next one, number five, AI inference at the edge shows real revenue. C+ is probably a generous grade here. We said that edge computing is going to be a significant trend in 2025. I think certainly the narrative around edge is there. We're seeing some deals, like you saw the NVIDIA deal with Nokia at GTC DC. John Furrier has talked about hyperconverged at the edge and sort of a new sort of infrastructure and architecture emerging. Processing data closer to the source for latency. A lot of talk about robotics and physical AI. But really it hasn't taken off to the extent that we had hoped. Obviously the silicon players are all talking about it, but the reality is that the real revenue is still not quite there. And so that's why we gave ourselves a C or a C plus on that one. All right, next one, number six, public cloud surpasses $1 trillion in revenue. These are our preliminary estimates of IaaS, PaaS, and SaaS. And you can see Microsoft leads cloud with $188 billion is our forecast for 2025. It's higher than many, but we think they're probably gonna get there when you add them all up. This is the CUBE research data, and it's all in IaaS, PaaS, and SaaS. It, of course, excludes 2025 Q4, calendar Q4 actuals. And you can see down the bottom right, $980 billion is where we're at. So it's short of our trillion. And with a big other. But others include like Shopify and Atlassian and other non-traditional SaaS, which is why it's so large. But we still didn't get to a trillion, but we're almost there. So we gave ourselves a B minus. All right, let's go on to the next one. AI supercharges, not replaces RPA. Our thinking here was that the plumbing of RPA was going to be advantageous as core infrastructure for AI. I would say in general, it didn't really happen. That's part of the narrative that you hear around RPA. We gave ourselves a C plus here because there is some evidence of that. It certainly makes logical sense that AI is going to be seen as complementary. And I think that's true when you talk to customers, you know, at, for instance, the UiPath event, they definitely see it that way, but it definitely was not a broad-based trend, and you can't really see it here, but you could see we showed, you know, January 2025, this is the picture, and we superimposed October 2025. Power Automate, you know, dominates. UiPath, you know, kind of consolidated a little bit and came back to the pack, even though they're not just RPA, they're much more than that, they're on automation, but they are an indicator. So we felt that parts of this were right, that definitely the last point here, agent control frameworks are emerging as a critical part of AI software stack. We see that as happening, but it's still early days. And that process mining and mapping and workflow optimization supporting agentic AI. But again, C plus because it wasn't widespread. You're certainly seeing you know, some of that activity in RPA accounts. Celonis is another one that's really pushing the process. You're seeing Salesforce and Palantir doing some good work there, but generally speaking, it was something that I don't think was a direct hit. All right, number eight, IPOs slowly ramp in first half, pick up in second half into 2026. I think we nailed that. You know, you saw a pretty tepid IPO market in the first half. We definitely see activity picking up in the second half. Certainly a lot of crypto activity. Of course, this is our conversation with Veeam, which we expect to go IPO. I'm not sure if we're going to call it for 2026, but companies like Sneak, like Veeam, we'll see about Databricks and Anthropic. You know, there's a lot of talk about those guys going public, but you know, we'll wait and judge that in our final predictions post. But I think in general, you know, we got this one, you know, pretty much right on. Okay, the next one, number nine, control point moves from the database up the stack toward open table formats and catalogs, but the value increasingly moves to the application layer. We gave ourselves a B plus on this one. You can see the ETR data from the Flash survey, which data open table formats are you using now or planning to use in the next 6 to 12 months. Iceberg is the big winner there. I think we called that one, so hence the B plus. But I would say that we have not seen that obvious value move to the application layer as fast as we saw, you know, Delta and Iceberg merging. Still a lot of talk around that, maybe taking longer than we hoped. This idea of bringing any data engine to any data, I think is clearly happening from the buyer sentiment, and this does change the competitive dynamic. But we're seeing, you know, some collaboration in the industry around open table formats and around semantics, which is a positive thing. And so, you know, decent call, but not necessarily a home run. All right, and the last one, number 10, AI won't kill jobs in 2025. It's going to create jobs longer term. Obviously, we can't tell with the longer term yet. That remains to be seen. This is a survey results from ETR, which says we will slow hiring as a direct result of our AI spending. You saw this is very small, you know, percentage of customers, a negative correlation here is what this chart shows us. Same thing as we will reduce our headcount as a direct result of our AI spending. That was last year, so that was the expectation. So why did we give ourselves a C minus? Well, we gave ourselves a C minus because there's certainly a narrative in the industry that AI is taking jobs. There's a belief that entry-level jobs are not being filled by recent college graduates, specifically because of AI. Whether or not that's true remains to be, so it is up for debate, but certainly the headlines would suggest that. Rebecca Knight and I kind of debated this at one of our events. I think it was UiPath Fusion. I think she called it a crisis. I think many people believe it is a crisis. I think if you look at these stats in terms of the percent of college, recent college graduates that are unemployed, it's higher than the unemployment rate. So you could say, you know, AI maybe indirectly has is a factor, because even if it's just sentiment, companies, you know, using AI as an excuse or not wanting to over-rotate and over-invest like they did in COVID in staff, you're seeing a lot of tech companies kind of reduce staff. We certainly saw that at some of the hyperscalers and Amazon in particular, that who overhired during COVID. So is it necessarily directly related to AI? Maybe it's indirectly, or maybe it is direct, but we felt like it's not a clear-cut call, and so we sort of, you know, graded ourselves a little, you know, tougher on that one and gave ourselves a C minus. So that's it. Overall, we give ourselves a B minus for the year of our predictions in 2025, which I'm told is actually better than the C plus that we got last year. Remember, when we do these predictions, we try to identify things that can be quantified or can be determined, you know, on a binary basis. Yes, it happened. No, it did not. And we do give ourselves extra credit. But that's it for today. I appreciate you watching, and look for our predictions. As I say, coming up, Eric Bradley and I will be doing our 2026 enterprise predictions in January. The Data Gang and I doing our data predictions, and the CUBE research team as well. Thanks for watching. This is Dave Vellante for Breaking Analysis. We'll see you next time.